Hi everyone, welcome back to the channel. So today I wanted to do a very quick video on how I take flats using N.I.N.A's flat wizard in dynamic brightness mode. The default mode in N.I.N.A's flat wizard is actually the dynamic exposure mode, which works very well with non-dimmable flat panels or if you take sky flats. And I'll show you how I use that mode with a really cheap LED tracing panel when I was using a one-shot color camera. But in this video, I want to emphasize how much nicer the dynamic brightness mode can be, especially if you use a monochrome camera, which requires a larger number of filters to run through. This mode does require a programmatically dimmable flat panel, like this DIY ASCOM compatible flat panel, which I designed and built and talked about in a previous video, which I'll link to here. With this kind of setup, taking flats becomes a one-click operation, and you will be able to take perfect flats very quickly and efficiently every time and for every single one of your filters. So let's get started. So when I got started in astrophotography a couple of years ago, I did not want to spend too much money. So to take my flats, I ended up buying one of these LED tracing panels from Amazon for about $20. This one is manually dimmable using the power button, and it is powered using a USB cable that you connect to your computer or to your USB hub. I even made a frame out of foam board that I bought at my local craft store to fit the panel to my telescope, and I inserted an acrylic sheet to act as a diffuser. So at the time I was using a one-shot color camera, and so I had only two filters to run through. I had a luminance filter and a dual narrowband filter, which was the optolongate extreme. And so in N.I.N.A's flat wizard, there's a feature that allows you to pause between filters, and that would allow me to go ahead and dim the panel and even insert a couple of sheets of paper, because even at its lowest setting, this panel is still way too bright for my luminance filter. So recently I switched to a mono camera, and now I have seven filters: luminance, red, green, and blue, HA, O3, and S2. And all of these filters have very different transmission characteristics. So you can imagine that it becomes a real pain to have to pause between every filter and then go and dim and brighten the panel and insert or remove sheets of paper. So that's when I really started thinking about getting an ASCOM compatible flat panel. The ones on the market are great, but they're all expensive, so I made my own. But if you have an ASCOM compatible flat panel already, you can use it, and N.I.N.A's flat wizard supports it. So now I'm going to show you how I take my flats. I have my telescope set up in the backyard, so let's go check it out. All right, we're in the backyard. It's not dark yet. The telescope is all set up. All we have left to do is to install the flat panel. So to do this, I just take the telescope cover off and set the flat panel onto the dew shield of my telescope. There is a lip on the inside of my flat panel that fits exactly the diameter of the dew shield, and that's how the panel stays in place all on its own. It is connected via two cables. There's a USB-C cable that allows the computer to send commands to the panel, and then there's a 12-volt DC cable to power the LED strip. Note that I'm using a Pegasus Astro Pocket Power Box Advance here, and that's what the panel is connected to. All right, I think we're all set. So tonight, to take our flats, we're going to control the telescope remotely. So let's go inside. All right, so while we wait for the sky to get dark, let's quickly review a few best practices when taking flats. The first one is to slew the telescope to the zenith. And as you'll see, N.I.N.A's flat wizard actually has that functionality built in, and I'll show you how to use it. This moves the telescope in a vertical position, which cancels any possible flexure that you might have in your imaging system. The second rule is to take flats in a dark environment, and that is to mitigate any possibility of light leak in your imaging system. Additionally, it might be a good idea to take your flats at a temperature near the temperature that you'll be imaging at. And the reason for this is that
your telescope focal length will change as the temperature changes. Most of us take our flats in the evening while we wait for the sky to get dark, or in the morning after our imaging session. So usually this condition is met, but basically what this rule means is don't take your flats in the middle of the day. This is probably the most important rule. Target 30 to 50% mean ADU. The reason for this rule is that CMOS sensors, I don't know about CCD, but CMOS sensors are not perfectly linear over their entire range. Especially when they reach saturation, the number of electrons that each pixel can store is not a linear function of the number of photons that that pixel received. And that's a huge issue with flats because of the mathematical operations involved during pre-processing. So the general recommended range is 30 to 50%. I think N.I.N.A's flat wizard by default tells you to target 35%, which is reasonable. Set the exposure to at least 1 second. If you use a flat panel, in all likelihood, it is actually illuminated by LEDs. And LEDs are usually dimmed using something called a PWM signal. PWM stands for pulse wave modulation. And with the first version of my DIY ASCOM compatible flat panel, I remember that if I were to use an exposure as short as 0.1 second, for example, I would see very clearly some artifacts in my flat frames. And that is because I was using the default PWM frequency of 700 Hz on the microcontroller that I'm using. I later made a small firmware update, and I was able to bump the PWM frequency to 20 kHz. And with that change, I am now able to take exposures as short as 0.1 second and get very clean flats. But just to be on the safe side, target 1 second and you'll probably be fine. Always rotate the filter wheel in the same direction. Most filter wheels, I think, have an option in their driver to always rotate the filters in the same direction. I know that the driver for ZWO filter wheels have that option, it's a little checkbox, in the driver settings dialog. And this option basically removes any possibility of backlash in the filter wheel mechanism that might cause your filters to not end up exactly in the same spot when you take your light frames and when you take your flat frames. So it's a very simple fix. Just open the driver settings dialog and see and look for that option and check it if it's available to you. Cool your camera to its operating temperature. This is actually not a huge deal with modern CMOS cameras because they have such a low dark current, but I think in this case, rigor doesn't cost anything, so go ahead and cool your camera before taking your flats and you'll have some peace of mind. And finally, move the focuser to its approximate position. You don't need to have perfect focus, and I think there was a video by Quiv the Lazy Geek, which I'll link to here, that covers that topic. So again, you don't need to have perfect focus, but you need to be in the right neighborhood. So just move your focuser to its approximate focus position before you take your flats. All right, so now let's apply these best practices to the flats that we're going to take together.
A few moments later.
All right, so I'm now connected to the computer that rides on the back of my telescope via remote desktop. So the first step is to connect all of the equipment. So let's start with the camera. And then let's start cooling the camera. The next step is to connect the filter wheel. And before I connect it, let me show you what the settings dialog looks like for ZWO filter wheels. You see this option? If it is checked, then it tells the filter wheel to always rotate in the same direction. And that is what you want in this case. So let's connect the filter wheel and then the focuser. And let's move the focuser to its approximate focus position, which in my case is 14,500 steps. And then finally, let's connect to the mount. All right, so we're all set. Let's wait for the camera to reach its final temperature, which is negative 5 Celsius degrees in my case, and then we'll go to the next step. All right, so the camera has reached its final temperature, so now we're ready for the next step, which is to connect to the flat panel. So it takes a few seconds, and then we're going to turn on the flat panel by setting an arbitrary value. So for example, we're going to set it to 3, which I know works fairly well with my luminance filter, and an exposure of 1 second. All right, so the panel is turned on now. Let's make sure that we have our luminance filter selected. And then we're going to try a 1 second exposure. And this is what we get. And this is a really good looking flat, and the mean ADU is roughly in the right neighborhood of about 30%. Now let's try another filter. So for example, let's try O3. And then let's take an exposure of 1 second as well. So in this case, it's way too dark, obviously. So now we're going to bump the brightness to maybe 200. And try to take an image again. That looks a little bit better. Looks like for O3, we might have to take a slightly longer exposure, maybe 2 seconds. That looks pretty good. We can try a brightness of 250. And try again. Yeah, that looks pretty good. I think these are the right values. All right, so the point here is that before you run the flat wizard for the very first time, you have to have some idea of how bright the panel needs to be and the exposure time for every single one of your filter. So as you saw in what I just did, it's a bit of a trial and error process. It only takes 5 minutes, and you only really have to do it once. And then after that, once you have all the values, you can go to the flat wizard. So let's do that next. All right, so let's open the flat wizard. By default, it is in dynamic exposure mode, but because we have a programmatically dimmable flat panel, let's enable the dynamic brightness mode. Also, because we have multiple filters, we're going to go to the multi-mode. And then here you see all of the filters that we have in our filter wheel. So because this is just an example, I'm only going to take one flat per filter, but under normal situation, I would take 50 flats per filter and also 50 dark flats. All right, so all of the filters are enabled, and I have filled out all of the necessary values that the flat wizard needs in order to take the flats. So in particular, I set the minimum and maximum brightness of the panel for each filter, along with the exposure time and the histogram min target. So let's look at another example here. For the O3 filter, I set a minimum brightness of 200, a maximum brightness of 240, an exposure time of 3 seconds, and an histogram min target of 35%, and a tolerance of 10%, which means that we should be in the range shown here. All right, so the next step is to slew the telescope to the zenith. So there's the button that is built in directly to the Flat Wizard UI. So let's go ahead and click on it. And we can go ahead and start taking our flats. Okay, so the flat wizard is completed, and the flats are now on my hard drive, and they're ready to be used in PixitSight, for example. So the next time you run the flat wizard, it will go a little bit faster. If you go to the equipment tab, flat panel, you see there's this table here, and N.I.N.A actually remembers the values that it ended up settling on. So for example, even though I set a minimum brightness of 3, and a maximum brightness of 5 for my luminance filter with an exposure of 1 second, N.I.N.A actually figured out that a brightness of 4 was ideal. And so the next time you run the flat wizard, it starts off directly with these values, and it will go a little bit faster. So as you saw, for me, taking flats is just clicking a button, then it takes a few minutes, I just let it do its thing, and then I end up with perfect flats every single time. So this is an approach that I highly recommend.
All right, so that's all I have for you today. I hope that you found this video useful. If you're new to the channel, I usually post about astronomy and astrophotography, but I have a lot of ideas for future videos, including things like equipment reviews or even spectroscopy, since that is a topic of interest for me and something I'm starting to get into. So if you don't want to miss any videos, make sure that you're subscribed and also click like so that the channel becomes more discoverable to other viewers. Until next time, thank you for watching.